alongside me here in Antigua, former England fast bowler Stephen Finn, Australia writer and broadcaster with the ABC, Jeff Lemon, also here. A remarkable day, really, in Antigua. England beating Namibia and the weather to reach the Super 8 stages. Margin of victory, 41 runs via DLS. For a long time, looked like the weather was going to end England's defence. 3 hours was the delay because of what at times was really torrential rain. Match reduced to 10 overs a side. Eventually, Stephen Finn, England's class told, but it will be relief that is the overriding emotion, I'm sure.
Yep, pure relief. There were so many times when we were sat up here in the commentary box watching the rain absolutely hammering on the window in front of us, lakes of water pouring off the covers onto the playing area as well. You thought that England would be done and dusted and on their way home, but credit to them, they stuck in there. They remained mentally switched on. They didn't have the most brilliant start with the bat, 18 from the first three overs. But as soon as Johnny Bairstow broke through the barrier there for England, the runs were flowing. I thought that it was an accomplished performance with the bat, showing power and a sensible approach to play through those 10 overs that they had. And then when it came to the ball, all of the learnings that they'd made from watching Namibia bowl in the first 10 overs, they put those into play. They used the big boundary well. There's a lot to be happy about again for the second game in a row for England.
122 for five England made from their 10 overs, which actually got reduced from 11 because there was another downpour. Harry Brook top scoring 47 from 20, and then in response Namibia could only muster 84 for three. So England winning by 41 runs because Namibia's target was revised to 127. Jeff Lemon, it was the sort of day that you couldn't really credit. It was ridiculous because everywhere you looked around the ground, there was blue sky, except overhead, just sitting like a little hat, was the rain falling consistently on this cricket ground. And it seemed implausible that it could be happening.
It did seem rather designed in some ways, and it was swirling around like a washing machine. That area over to the south where we can see the hills down there that we're still looking at now, that was clear for most of the day, but then at one point for about half an hour a huge rain squall came from that direction and blocked out all of that landscape, but most of it was coming from the other direction, from north to south. It was moving around all over the place, and it was so impressive, I thought, from England to keep the composure, because they would have been sitting there, and there was a point where, you know, as we ticked through the afternoon and then that really big downpour came in from the south, that there wasn't that much time left. And you thought, well, they're not going to get on here. They're going to get knocked out. To be sitting there, you're supposed to have a 1 o'clock start. You don't get on until 4 o'clock, then you come off for another rain delay. But to be able to sort of keep things together mentally, and after that start as well, where, you know, David Visa bowls a terrific first over that goes for one. Joss Butler, fourth ball duck, the ball swung through him by Trumpleman, and then Visa gets Phil Salt out in the third over, and England are really struggling at that point, and they're going at a runner ball, and they've lost their two gun openers, and so things could have fallen apart from that point. The fact that they didn't, and the fact that they were able to finish so strongly, you know, Bairstow and Brook with the recovery, and then Moeen Ali and Liam Livingston making sure that they iced the cake, that says volumes for the calm and composure that England team didn't allow the possibility of what could go wrong to derail them.
Yeah, and it's difficult, those games, Stephen. You've been in dressing rooms, no doubt, over the years where you've been waiting for the rain to stop and you've got to get going quickly and it might be reduced and you have to come up with all sorts of different plans and all these difficult challenges that come about on a rainy day.
The hardest thing is staying present. I think that runs true for a sportsman in any, or a sports person in any situation that they find themselves, but more so in such an important game for England. They'd have been sat there knowing that when they got out there, they'd be favourites, but every moment that game was shortened, you'd feel as though it was bringing Namibia more into the game. And there would have been a lot of times in that dressing room where you'd have had the dejection of thinking that you were on the plane home tomorrow morning, having not really had a chance, what it feels like, to get out there and play cricket at all. And the criticism that would have come with that. So the fact that they remained mentally fresh to go out there, have those tricky three overs, and have a little reset and then really explode and give a really good account of themselves as the day went on, I think they deserve a lot of credit for.
Now, early on in the day, when it looked all pretty bleak, in the commentary box. We invited members of the written press to join us as well. And we weren't quite doing the wrap-up of England's tournament, where it all went wrong as they headed home. But we weren't far from it, because a washout in this game or the game in St. Lucia between Scotland and Australia would have sent England out of this tournament.
Yeah, we weren't quite doing the post-mortem, but we were sitting in the ambulance on the way to the hospital. It did feel like that was the way it was going to go, and we talked about how difficult it would be to assess this campaign, given that it's been so truncated, given that, you know, if we were assuming that this game was washed off, we would have had two washouts from two of England's games. We would only have had the game against Oman, which was a mismatch in England's favour, and the one game against Australia where they were well beaten, to be able to try to make any assessment. There's really no assessment you could make if that was where the tournament ended. Now there will be an opportunity, provided we don't all get washed out during the Super 8s, mind you, because the weather's not that great at the moment. But there'll be an opportunity to see England go into that group, you know, come up against some strong sides. And we've often seen this in World Cups, that teams that have scrappy starts to a campaign but manage to survive can often get a head of steam going through the later stages.
Indeed. England in their two successes in recent years in the T20 World Cup of 2022 and the 50-ever World Cup of 2019 as well. Let's get some reaction then from the England camp. After the game, I went down to the boundary edge, spoke to Joss Butler, the England captain. Has to be said, of course, at that point, he didn't know the outcome of the game between Australia and Scotland.
Relief at the moment. I will wait and see what happens. But, I thought everyone dealt with it really well. The rain was hanging around, some heavy downpours at times as well. So credit to the ground staff and the umpires for getting us out there. And I thought as players, we handled it really well and put in a good performance.
Talk me through your emotions as you're sitting there watching the rain fall and the minutes tick by.
Well, it's not a lot you can do, really. I think you're just sort of praying, really, that the clouds will move away. There's plenty of blue sky around, but there seemed to be just a big black cloud that was right over the ground. But, obviously really thankful that we got out there, and a credit to the guys, I think, who handled it really well. That, you know, absolutely there's some anxieties and frustrations in the dressing room, but when we came to game time, we did really well.
Because it is a challenge when a game gets shortened like that to try and find your rhythm quickly as well.
Yeah, absolutely, and losing the toss as well. You weren't sure how the wicket was going to play, and I thought it was tricky. I thought 120-odd is a brilliant score on there. The real credit to Bairstow and Brooke, especially the start of that partnership, and then Moeen and Libby with some great cameos.
Seeing the squad being used in its fullness, Sam Curran coming in today, what was the thinking there?
No, we felt like we'd need an extra seamer. Initially, if we had a full game, we were going with the same team as the last game, but obviously with the changing conditions, we felt like we needed four seam bowling options. And who else did we choose? Chris Jordan came in as well. We felt like with his experience, death overs, skills, also a lot of guys who sort of played some T10 cricket are quite used to how it is. So yeah, and I think huge credit to the way sort of Will Jackson, Mark Wood handled that as well. Yeah? Like I said, guys coming in terms of Curran and Jordan who weren't expecting to play today, and then two guys who were expecting to play missing out. So real credit to those guys.
So those decisions were made late on account of the fact that the game was reduced?
Yeah, well, obviously we turned up expecting to play a 20-over game, and then, you know, as the situation changes, we have to change our thinking as well.
How will you reflect? I know we can't quite say yet ultimately this group, but how will you reflect on your team's performances in this group stage?
I think we've done well. I think obviously the game against Scotland's rained off. We were outplayed by Australia, and then the two performances here, we've done what we needed to do.
Oman and Namibia games that you had to win and win well. Does it feel like this team is finding its groove now in the tournament?
Yeah, it's always been still been a little bit truncated, but look, fingers crossed that we can progress. And yeah, absolutely. I think it showed today, like guys like Harry Brooks not batted much recently, coming and playing phenomenal in innings. So we've got really good squad, we've got really good players in it, and if we can hopefully progress, hopefully we can do well.
Well, Joss Butler speaking there. Stephen, you know him very well, and he said, you know, quite philosophically, not much you can do other than pray that the rain goes away. But it would have been for him, given everything that his captaincy, all of these question marks over the last few weeks and months, he would have been thinking, please, just give us a chance to get out there.
Yeah, and also because I think in the build-up to this tournament, they have been a lot more settled. In terms of the team that they've been picking, I think when the criticism from me of that 50-over World Cup was that in the build-up to the tournament, it didn't feel as though England knew their best team, and it felt as though even on the first game of the tournament, the team sheet came out and you were surprised about who they'd picked. There was nothing like that coming into this tournament. So I think if they were to have gone out today because of it being rained out, then I think they'd have been sat in the dressing room saying, well, I think we actually learned from our lessons and the mistakes that we made in that 50-over World Cup. And we didn't really have an opportunity to be able to show people how good we are at cricket. I think now they've given themselves the opportunity to progress to the next stage. And it's when they'll be truly tested, and where people can truly judge, I think, where they're at as a team is how they'll perform in these Super 8s. But certainly there'd have been a period of time in that dressing room there where Jos Buttler would have been sat in the corner cursing his luck at watching this rain tipping down in front of him.
The thing about knowing the best team is interesting, considering the late rain that they pulled to make changes once the game got reduced, once they knew it was an 11 and over side. They had Sam Curran come in, and they left Mark Wood out. They had Chris Jordan come in, and they left Will Jacks out. So interesting, the tactical considerations that made them think, you know, these players will be more useful in this short form, whether it was needing Curran and Jordan as a backup to club down the order because wickets might go in a rush, or whether it was perhaps that somebody at Mark Wood's pace will be attacked more and thus is more likely to give away boundaries when players are going really hard at him. We did see that with Jofra Archer a bit, where some top edges carried for 4 or 6, and maybe they were worried that Wood would be more of the same. I'm not sure what the tactical rationale was, but it shows a confidence from a team set up to be willing to make the changes and to not be stubborn in the way they did things. And Namibia were stubborn in that run chase. They sent their normal openers out, neither of whom have particularly fast scoring records really, and you know, rather than sending out their known boundary hitters in the likes of David Visa or Gerhard Erasmus, who've been the more attacking sort of players, they just stuck with what they already had, and it failed dismally.
And it's doing stuff with conviction. I think what I've seen so far, they had a bad first 5 overs against Australia, which cost them that game. And even though Jos Buttler was criticised for his decisions, he still did it with confidence, I think, and with informed logic about bowling Will Jacks that second over because of how much it had turned the first over. So there's logic and conviction behind that, and I've seen that all the way throughout, including those two changes today. So it's funny how world tournaments and how you build momentum as you go through the tournament, it's amazing what experiences like that and being really close to the brink of going out, what that can do for you as a team. And that'll be all the conversations that England will be having, will be how do we build on this, how do we keep gaining confidence, because we do know when they hit their straps, they're one of the most dangerous teams in the world.
And they would have been expected to beat Oman and Namibia comfortably, but they've been really impressive in these two games. And you have to say that when you've got a team like Oman, a team like Namibia, who you're expected to beat, being ruthless can sometimes actually be quite challenging.
Well, there's always the possibility of getting it wrong, right? You can be too aggressive and end up tripping over your own feet. You can be aggressive in a way that comes across as cockiness, and cockiness is often punished in a sporting context. Or you also leave yourself open to criticism because you know that there's a degree of pressure that if you're not beating up on these teams, if you're not beating them by big margins, then people will be getting stuck into you there. So it can be complicated, I suppose, when there is an expectation that you should be able to comfortably beat these sides, when a lot of these teams aren't that easy to beat anymore.
What about the momentum that comes from relief? Because England were staring at the journey home, reigning champions, and you could see the headlines now, reigning champions spelt both ways, etc., etc., and all of those questions that actually wouldn't have really been answered because England wouldn't have had the chance to say, yeah, we are a good side, we can prove that we're a good side, and not to be able to even be eliminated on your own terms. It would have been such a frustration. So Stephen, there is a sense that they can play with a bit of freedom. There's the relief of having got through today.
Yeah, there is the relief of having got through today, but there would have been an expectation when they turned up here that they would definitely come through the group. So there's a bit of relief, but the confidence that they will take from these two performances, and yes, it's against two teams that they should definitely be beating 99 times out of 100 anyway. But I think you look today, Johnny Bairstow, who hadn't looked fluent at all since we've seen him in this team batting at number four over the last few weeks. He got an important 31 today. Harry Brook again, someone who's not hit the most fluency out here in this tournament, scored a brilliant 47 and really propelled. And it's those guys in that middle order that will take the most from this game today in particular, I think, in knowing that they adjusted to the conditions, they counter-punch back, they found the power that everyone knows that they have, and they put England in a really commanding position. So just as they go along, they're just ticking off little milestones, little checkpoints to make sure that all of their team is in order and has confidence going into those Super 8s.
And speaking of, Australia and India will be avoided until at least the semi-finals. So it'll be a Super 8s group with South Africa and the two co-hosts, USA and West Indies. I mean, some fun games in there, Jeff.
Well, it's interesting, and that pairing, that grouping gives England a great chance to go through. The West Indies have been playing pretty well, although they were wobbly in their first game against Papua New Guinea. We've seen South Africa, sure, they've won four in a row, but they've almost lost all of them, and they've all been very low-scoring games. Their top four can't seem to get a run, and they're somehow managing to close games out, but they haven't looked remotely convincing, certainly on the batting side of things. And they had quite a bit of luck in beating Nepal the other night on that last ball finish. And then, you know, the USA are a team that England should feel that they can comfortably beat, even though the USA have some momentum behind them.
Fitting, you'd expect that England in a group like that would fancy making it through to the semi-finals, but there are going to be some good tests against good teams and also the pressure of playing against the hosts.
Well, absolutely. Two teams that I fancied coming into this tournament were South Africa and the West Indies. I think the West Indies, because of the batting power that they have and the local knowledge and the support behind them, I think could be a real big contributing factor to them going far in this tournament. And South Africa, their batting unit hasn't fired yet, but you feel as though it might be a matter of time until they do, on a good surface, manage to really fire. And they've got a wonderful bowling unit with almost every base covered. So there are challenging games in there, but certainly, again, T20 is a game where one or two people can have a day out and it completely changes the fortunes of your team, and everyone comes in off the back of that. England have had two brilliant performances against two of the weaker teams. That should give them confidence that they can go and give a better account of themselves against one of the stronger teams in these Super 8s.
So England have pipped Scotland to the Super 8 stage. Scots beaten by Australia in St. Lucia. Let's get reaction to that game with Kasim Sheikh, Atif Nawaz and Nikesh Raghani.
So Scotland unable to restrict Australia then. 181 was the target. They were in the game for large parts, but eventually Australia getting home by 5 wickets, 2 balls remaining. Half centuries for Marcus Stoinis and for Travis Head up at the top of the order. So heartbreak for Scotland. England, of course, go through with that defeat for the Scots. Former Scotland international Kasim Sheikh and Atif Nawaz joining me for this one. Kasim, you must be gutted at that result at the halfway stage, 180 for 5. It was a really, really good effort from Scotland with the bat. They kept it tight with the ball early on, but in the end, Australia's class just showing up.
Yeah, it was always a concern with the might of Australia's batting that, you know, 180 might not quite be enough. But to get 180 in the first place against Australia was phenomenal. You know, Brandon McMullen is just a superb talent that Scotland have unearthed at the age of 24. Great signs for the future. At one point, I thought he had the ability to go on and score 100. If he'd gone on and maybe scored another 20, 30, the rate he was going, Scotland might have been 200 plus. I think that would have been enough. 180 was still a phenomenal achievement. And first 6 overs of the power play, they kept Australia quiet, took a few early wickets. But they've just got so many dangerous batsmen. Like, you know, you get rid of Maxwell and Stoinis comes out to bat and he was just the coolest man on the pitch tonight. He just seemed to know that he could put the foot on the accelerator at any point and take the game away from Scotland.
Absolutely, yeah. Player of the Match award for Marcus Stoinis, of course. But with the bat, Scotland, you mentioned there, Brandon McMullen, 60 from 34. Good innings from Richie Berington, the skipper as well, 42 at the end, not out. George Munsey at the top of the order. We know that he's been in good form as well, 35 from 23. There were good contributions all the way down, even Matthew Cross coming in at the end, 18 from 11, a 4 and a 6 for him in his innings. Every time you thought Scotland, they've lost a wicket, they've lost a couple, are they going to be able to carry on this momentum? Yes, they fell away just a touch maybe towards the back end of the innings, but that momentum just kept on going, and you could see that real fight and that desire, not just with the bat, but with the ball, as you say, you know, taking that early wicket of David Warner. Australia were 3 for 1 after the first two overs as well. It was an outstanding effort. And Atif, I mean, you know, we've seen a little bit of Scotland in this tournament, but just their fight and their will and their desire, I think that's what stood out for me tonight.
Absolutely. I mean, for me, they'd sort of won three quarters of the game. You know, at the 10 over mark, they were sort of just about, you know, keeping Australia, you know, at bay. They had a better power play than Australia did as well. They managed to get two Australian wickets in the power play. They managed to get them to score a run of ball in their power play. So they played large sections, large chunks of the game really, really well. It's worth stressing that Australia didn't have a very good game, despite the fact that they've chased 180, which is quite frightening that they can do that when they play under par. But they put down, you know, five pretty, you know, regulation, I'm going to say, chances out in the field. You know, their sort of body language, they didn't look massively motivated. Okay, they were already through to the Super 8s before the game, but they just looked a little bit sluggish to me, generally, Australia, to let Scotland get away to 180. But what was really frightening was the calmness that Marcus Stoinis, the player of the match, played his innings with, got to a half century at a strike rate of greater than 200. Just felt like he had the game in hand always, barely sort of broke a sweat or gave any real expressions. I mean, there was a phase in the game where Australia needed 12 and over to win the game, and that's with 9 overs remaining. But he was always so calm, and he's really broke the back of the chase alongside Travis Head. There was an over in the middle where Safian Sharif went for 24, despite getting a wicket. So he got a wicket in the over, but he still went for 24, and it felt like at that point Australia had sort of got over the hump, and at that point it was always going to be hard work for Scotland to get back in. You see this happen often with teams like Australia and teams that are less, you know, that don't play that elite level of cricket as often. Scotland, you know, not a full member nation, an associate nation, even though they have a huge amount of experience of playing in these tournaments dating back to 1999. There's always a moment in these games where associate nations are tested, put under intense pressure. When Australia bought that pressure today in the last quarter of this match, that's where Scotland, you know, sort of fell away under the heat, I'm going to say. That's where some chances were put down. That's where, you know, the batters were given a few freebies. You have to sort of salute the determination and the heart of the Scottish performance. Of course you do. But it's really, the headline for me is that Australia, even when they're not quite on it, are unbelievably strong. Of course, fortuitous result for England, though.
Absolutely, yeah. And look, Australia going through to the Super 8s as well with a 100% winning record as well. It's important to take momentum into that next stage of the competition. But Gassim, obviously a motivating factor for Scotland tonight would have been not just to get through to the Super 8s. Obviously, that's their primary target, but it would have been a huge bonus to knock England out and go through at England's expense. You could sense that extra bit of motivation for the Scots. And it seemed as though Lady Luck was on their side, because as Atif mentioned there, 4 or 5 pretty simple chances dropped out there by Australia when Scotland were batting. Even with the ball, you know, things just seemed to be going Scotland's way in the field up until the back end of the innings, or even a little bit before that. Travis Head was dropped, difficult chance down at long on. Tim David was dropped in the last over. Who knows whether or not that would have made a difference. They needed 3 from 4 when he hit that shot out to deep mid-wicket. Should have been taken at this level. It's just, it seems to me as though if Scotland were to win tonight against a side like Australia, they needed to have everything go absolutely 100% perfectly. Just those couple of little things which didn't quite go their way. That over from Safian Sharif as well that went for 24. Big turning point in that chase. Just didn't quite go perfectly. If you were a teacher and you were marking this as a test paper, you'd probably give it 90-something percent, wouldn't you? But it's not quite there.
Fine margins at this level. You're playing against the best team in the world, in Australia. And yes, you have to be honest and look back that the Travis Head drop catch has led to a really dangerous partnership between Travis Head and Stoinis that completely changed the match around. And look, it was a tough catch. That was a really tough catch. The catch at the end of the game should have been taken. That was a lot more straightforward. But Michael Jones was running back over his head. The ball was swirling in the air. But if you get two hands to it at this level, then you have to take them. I know that sounds harsh, and you know, but it's the harsh reality of playing at this level. And if that catch gets taken, it's a different game. You know, Travis Head, you know, I didn't think it was one of his better innings today. I think he rode his luck a little bit. But the fact that he was then able to continue on with Marcus Stoinis, the game just started to get taken away from Scotland at that point. But you're both absolutely spot on. The over from Safyan Sharif that went for 24 was where the game completely changed. You kept talking about it. We were looking at the win predictor and we were saying, you know, I was saying, oh, Scotland 80% at one point, I think it was 75-80%. And we all talked about, yeah, but that can change in one over. And that was a perfect example, because as soon as that over finished, the target looked, you know, a lot more achievable for Australia. If anything, Australia were in the driving seat. But, you know, we've touched on it a few times. Fine margins at this level. Yes, Scotland have been playing in Cricket World Cup since 99, but we don't get to play against these teams very often. Amazing news that Australia are going to come to Scotland and play Scotland in three T20 matches. That's welcome news, because, you know, we're lucky normally if we maybe get a game every couple of years and it's only one off. For Australia to come and visit for three T20s, that's the kind of fixtures that Scotland need more of. And I think if they get more exposure to it, you see firsthand, you know, we can compete at this level, and it's just fine margins. And if I was a teacher, yeah, I would have given them a, you know, 95% today, and the 5% that was not enough. But just shows you that we have to play the perfect game in Australia, we're still able to get over the line with not playing, far from playing their perfect game. And that's just the nature of cricket at this level.
Absolutely. But look, Australia, you know, one of the strongest sides in the world, absolutely outstanding record in ICC tournaments as well, to push them so far. And, you know, their performance against England with the bat as well. I know that match was rained off, but 90 without loss after the first 10 overs. England set that revised target, if they were to get back on, of 109 to win from 10 overs. That would have been a tough chase for England. So they would have pushed England pretty hard as well. Their performances in this T20 World Cup have been outstanding. They have improved as a side. You know, there's been some good performances from some of the other associate nations too, USA being the prime example. What do you think this performance in this T20 World Cup will do for Scottish cricket going forward, and how can they capitalise on this and use this as a springboard to their next target?
The harsh reality is that we haven't beaten a big test playing nation. You know, Ireland have become such a success because of the achievements they had in the World Cup, beating England many, many years ago now. The Netherlands have beaten England in a World Cup as well. So, you know, making it to the Super 8s would have been, you know, a dream come true for Scottish cricket, and who knows where that could have taken them to. But, I mean, I just hope the ICC take note of playing, you know, and invest more in these type of countries, because I'm enjoying this World Cup because we're getting to see countries from, you know, more countries playing the game. And if they're given more exposure at that level, it's only going to benefit world cricket. So grow the game as much as possible. And I hope that Scotland will be recognised for their performances. And it's already earned them, I think, a series against Australia. The one I really want to see is, you know, we only have to drive down the motorway and we're in England, and England can drive down the motorway and they're in Scotland. You know, I would love a home and away series over a couple of summers, you know, three T20s or something along those lines. And the fact that that was the first time Scotland ever played England in a T20 ever, it's a little bit of a worry for me. I mean, I would love to see it. And it brings the excitement as well. And if England were to come and visit Scotland, I'm sure it would encourage more and more people to take up cricket and get involved. So if the heads of the ECB are listening, let's get a series sorted, because we have unfinished business. After that first game, I think we all want to see a series played out there.
Atif?
Yeah, I'm on board with that. Wouldn't we like to see it? I mean, just to, you know, tack on to that point, I think absolutely this World Cup has really felt more like a World Cup than any other World Cup before, in cricket at least, because we've got 20 teams, different countries, and a lot of teams are there on merit. It's not like sort of previous World Cups where it's felt like, you know, there's a genuine gulf, and if you know, an upset isn't really going to happen, that you always know who's really going to win. In this World Cup, it's genuinely been quite tight now between most teams. There are the odd mismatches, but not as many as people had predicted, I think. And you've got some big results as well, with the USA going through to the Super 8 stage and Scotland pushing so hard, you know, right on the cusp of a position there. I think this is a wonderful thing for the game. I think Scotland have some talent as well that's going to do the rounds. I think, you know, the big thing these days in T20 cricket particularly is getting contracts in franchise leagues. You know, Brandon McMullen, so impressive today. Just, I think that was a real breakthrough innings. I know he's already played some franchise cricket for the Abu Dhabi Knight Riders and the ILT20, but you know, I think, you know, people in maybe the IPL, the Big Bash, even SA20, PSL, you know, other people taking note, getting some of those players through, and that's how you make the kind of progress that some of the Ireland players have made. We've seen Paul Sterling turning up in different leagues around the world. The Afghanistan players, I mean, look at the leaps and bounds that they've come on. They're probably one of the favourites for this tournament now. So I think that's a big next step for the Scottish players. Absolutely, bilateral cricket is very important with full member nations. I'm hoping off the back of this World Cup, actually, a lot of countries will start doing that, organising more series against associate teams. I think commercially, brands will be more interested as well. So this is an exciting time for cricket despite this result, although I'm sure right now England fans, Nikesh, they'll be breathing a huge sigh of relief.
They will be cock-a-hoop. So Scotland unable to get over the line, then losing out to Australia reaching their target of 181 with 5 wickets remaining and 2 balls to spare. They go through to the Super 8s with 100% record, and with them go England.
Thank you.